Patrice Andres was a 38-year-old woman living in Cumming, Georgia, with her husband Rob and her 15-year-old son, Pistol. She met Rob when she was 30 years old and he was 50. Rob described himself as the happiest man in the world to have been married with Patrice. She had her own hair salon where she would cut or dye her clients' hair. After she was done with her clients, they would sit there and talk with her for hours. The whole community loved her. She always had a passion for cutting people's hair and making them look good. That is why she worked hard to get her own hair salon and build her business to the point where she had lots of happy customers and kept coming back. Patrice was very involved in her son Pistol's life and attended every meet and game he had. She always wanted everyone around her to be happy. On the morning of the 15th of April 2004, Patrice woke Pistol up the way she usually did, by running on a treadmill. That morning, they argued a little because Pistol was in a hurry to get to school. She dropped him off at his high school before going to work. A few hours later, while Pistol was sitting in biology class, he was asked to go to the office. Once there, he was asked if there was any way he could get into touch with his mother. Pistol then called Patrice three times, but there was no answer. It was strange, since any time Patrice missed a call, she would immediately call back. Little did he know, his mom has been reported missing to the police by a client of hers because she was not at her hair salon. When Sheriff Ron Freeman got to the hair salon and couldn't find any sign of Patrice, he knew something was wrong. He noticed that her cash register was open and there was money missing. Her purse was found on the counter and her lunch was still uneaten in the microwave. Other than that, everything else in the salon was like it always would have been. Everyone was dumbfounded as to where she could be. One thing outside of the hair salon that was strange was where Patrice had parked her car. She always parked the car on the left side of the hair salon, but for some reason on this day, it was in front of the salon. There really wasn't a lot of evidence to point the investigators into one direction or another. Immediately though, they got helicopters in the sky and searchers on the ground to look for her in the woods behind the hair salon. After they couldn't find Patrice in the initial search, they had to look at a timeline of her disappearance. At 8:50 a.m, her first client, Pam Shepherd, arrives for her appointment. Pam told police that Patrice was distracted and not very attentive to her. At 11:05 a.m, Pam leaves the salon and Patrice is still there. 5 minutes later, at 11:10 a.m, Paul Cantor arrives for his haircut. He left the salon at 11:27 a.m. He received a phone call as he was leaving. That is how police knew what the time was. Then, at 11:35 a.m, a customer calls Patrice. The customer told police that Patrice was sort of short on the phone, which was unusual. The call lasted for about 2 minutes, until 11:37 a.m. The next call that came in was 11:50 a.m. and it goes unanswered. The conclusion that can be made is that something happened to Patrice in that 13 minutes. After having asked Pistol to try and get into contact with his mom to no avail, the police took him to Patrice's hair salon. Only then did they tell him that she was missing. Pistol was sure she would come back, she couldn't just be gone. Rob also later arrived at a hair salon. He was then informed that he would have to go to a station for some questioning. Rob claims since he has a degree in criminology, he wasn't surprised by this. He knew he would have to be questioned since he was Patrice's husband, and in some missing persons cases, it turns out that a spouse was responsible for the disappearance. It did not take long for the police to receive a possible lead. Two eyewitnesses came forward and they both saw pretty much the same thing. Also important to note that the two witnesses did not know each other at all. At 11:45 a.m, Tammy Fincher noticed that Patrice's car was parked in front of the store while she drove past the hair salon. She also noticed a Chevy Lumina parked right next to it. The Chevy Lumina did have a Georgia license plate, according to her. The second witness had also drove past the hair salon basically at the same time as Tammy, saw the same, but he believed it is a Ford Taurus or possibly a Malibu. Tammy Fincher saw two women standing in front of the car, one of them being really tall. A second witness, however, believes that a tall woman is actually a man with long hair. Since these two witnesses saw basically the same thing, and they are totally independent of each other, the police saw them as being credible. After searching through the woods for the trees for hours, young Pistol went back home. The next day he learned that Rob changed the locks of the house. Rob didn't allow Pistol to come back in at all. Pistol was 8 years old when Rob and Patrice got married on the 2nd of March 1997. Rob and Pistol never liked each other. Pistol remembers that in the first year, Rob was really nice and tried to be a stepfather. It didn't last long, however, and Rob totally changed his attitude towards Pistol. Rob would walk past his room and just say really crude stuff. This went on for years. Many of Patrice's friends describe Rob as being very jealous. Rob was especially jealous when Pistol got attention from Patrice. He wanted her all to himself. In the Unsolved Mysteries episode of Patrice's case, Pistol said as she talked about divorcing Rob a couple of weeks before her disappearance. Rob, on the other hand, denied this and said things were going very well from his point of view. After Rob changed the locks and Pistol couldn't get in, he had to go live with his father on a farm. As you can imagine, this was a really hard time in Pistol's life. His mom was gone, his stepdad kicked him out, and his father had crippling depression. As time went on, Pistol got more and more anxious about Patrice still being gone. Initially, he believed that she maybe went elsewhere to start a new life for them, away from Rob, and that she would be coming to pick him up anytime. Every single night, Patrice's father sat on his couch, looking out a window, just waiting for her to return. But she never did. One of the suspects that police looked at was Carrie Michael Hilton. The police knew that he was in the area on that day. He once made a statement that his favorite place to go was a hair salon when he was looking for easy targets, referring to women whose life he could end. Another suspect that police looked into was Jeremy Jones. On the surface, he appeared to be an average guy, but he liked to abuse women and then end their lives afterwards. Jeremy told police that he was driving and he decided to stop at a hair salon. He drew a picture of where his car was parked and where her car was parked, and was very accurate. He told investigators that he threw her body in Sweetwater Creek in Douglasville, Georgia. An extensive search was done of the area, but no sign of Patrice was found there at all. Soon after, Jeremy Jones withdrew his confession. Jeremy Jones and Carrie Michael Hilton are still considered suspects. 20 months after Patrice disappeared, on the 6th of December 2005, a man by the name of Albert Clark found a skull. The skull was found near the Lebanon Baptist Church, about 6 miles from Patrice's salon. It was quickly confirmed that the skull belonged to Patrice. After knowing that Patrice did not run away and that someone entered her life, Pistol went to the police telling them that he believes Rob is involved. Pistol believes that Patrice wanting a divorce upset Rob. Patrice's friends also believe Rob is involved. A lot of people that watched the Unsolved Mysteries episode also think that Rob might have something to do with it. Rob says it is impossible for him to be involved, time-wise. The police, on the other hand, said it is not impossible, just unlikely. Something that Rob did after seeing her remains in the funeral home was that he moved all of her bones around so that it could sort of resemble a body. He also showed everyone her ashes and talked about how he would sleep next to it every evening. Despite being a weirdo, the police could never find anything that would lead them to believe Rob was involved.